work, but I did in collaboration with the great Agustin Yabo, he's in this room, okay?
L'assistant informatique,
c'est ça? Yes.
Parce que j'ai rangé l'ordi, là.
So, et son nom sera trouvé là.
About the study of disabled gene regulatory networks and time optimal control strategies for such systems. Okay. Ça marche. Thank you to Lucy for all the pictures that I have stolen in her PhD thesis. Okay. Okay. So the topic that we are going to study is the models of genetic feedback loops. Okay. So I'm going to be very short and in order to explain the mechanisms. Okay. So the systems are some networks of inferences between genes or proteins which have a ring topology, because it is very common in practice. Okay. So they are based on the following very simplified mechanism, which is that the genes are coding for some proteins. Okay. But some proteins, called transcription factor, and we will focus on those on this case, also exert some feedback on the genes, okay, which can be either positive, either negative. Okay. So this leads to some graphs of interaction between proteins, where we have either activation in the case of the nice green arrows, okay, and for the red lines, okay, we have some inhibition, okay. So now, so we will try to, yeah, in this background, okay, first we want to investigate some optimal control strategies, and we are going to restrict to the case, a very basic case, okay? And we will present the model in the next slides, but we will, in our work, we will focus on simple vegetable, quite classical vegetable systems, which are the case of where we have a loop with only two inhibitions, okay, which is which has been implemented in Escherichia coli in the following article in 2000, okay, and it based on the fact that on two genes, LACAI and TETR, which where there are two inhibitions, okay. So such systems is known to have vegetable behavior, okay. Okay, so either one gene is expressed and the other is repressed. Either we are in the opposite case. Okay, so this is a system where we have two stable steady states. Mathematically, we have two stable steady states, and which can be formally written as 1,0 and 0,1. Okay, and our goal is to achieve transitions between those two states thanks to control. And what we want to do is in our work is to find the minimum time control strategies to achieve such transition. Okay, so the model that we will study is a classical piecewise affine model where we have the two variables which represent the expression of the genes, okay, which are X1 and X2. And we have some degradation rates, gamma 1, which are strictly positive, and gamma 2, okay. And what is called production rates, here K1 and K2, which multiply some step function, S minus, okay, with fixed thresholds, theta 1 and theta 2, Okay. We have this dynamics, and this dynamics is piecewise is a linear, sorry, in the four regions here. Okay, depending on the position with respect to the thresholds of the variable x1 and x2, and we will study this system on the invariant compact set K. Okay. Which depends on the constant values of the system. Okay, such system has two following the B-stable states, steady states. Sorry. Okay, where here we have the first x1 that is strongly expressed, and y x2 is equal to zero, and this is the opposite case. Okay. So, so just a technical fact is that here the two basins of attraction of the steady states are separated by a curve called the separatrix, which can be expressed by this formula. Okay, it has a x2 as a function of x1. Okay, here we have plotted the vector field, okay, which is a non-smooth vector field because of the step function in the dynamics. So we have points, lines where the dynamics is non-smooth at the threshold theta 1 and theta 2, okay, and in each zone, as I said previously, the dynamics is affine, okay, and so here we have the two steady states in orange and here in black, okay. And the idea is to achieve, thanks to some control, is to achieve some transition between this one toward this one, okay. Here on the vector field we see this curve here in dashed line, which is the separatrix between. In the zone B00 between the two basins of attraction of the steady states. Okay, I want you to understand that we also have here in this zone a curve which separates the two basins of attraction, but in our study we don't care because this zone actually is will not be interested by this zone in our control strategy, so I don't didn't plot the corresponding line. Okay, so now we can speak of control model. We will study this control model. So we have a multiplicative control U, okay, which is in front of the step function, okay, and we assume that U is multiplicative because it corresponds to the fact that using some inducer on the system, the model corresponds to the case where we use some inducer in order to modify the synthesis rate of messenger RNA on the system. Okay, so we, for the constraint and the control U, we assume that U has values in U min, U max. Okay. And where U min, U max are positive and satisfy the following inequality, okay. And we will see that they have to be well chosen, okay. Okay. So now, another technical slide is to understand when U is a static parameter, okay, actually the curve of the separatrix is modified by U. Okay, the separatrix moves when U is moving, okay, and it can be written like that. And the regions of attractivity are also varying. Okay, can be written as follows. Okay, so And here on this picture, we see how it moves actually. So here we have the region SU plus, here SU minus, okay. So now we introduce the optimal control problem. So actually, I thought that we want to achieve some transitions between the initial goal is to achieve some transitions between the two steady states, okay? But however, in the corresponding zones, there is a lack of controllability on one of the variables. So for instance, if you are in this zone, when you look at the dynamics, you cannot control the x1 component. You can control only the x2 component because this term here with the step function is equal to zero. So it will not be possible to reach in finite time this steady state, of course. So we relax the problem to the following. We want to minimize the time where x is satisfies the dynamics, leaving from one initial value x0, and we want to reach actually a target on x2 while imposing this constraint for x1 at the final time. It means that we want to reach a fixed value of x2 here in this zone. Okay, leaving from an initial condition in this zone. This is, relaxed version, but it means that if we choose x2f large enough, it means that when we have reached this target, the x2 is has a quite a high value, and the gene is highly expressed, while the other one is weakly expressed. Okay, and we are in the good zone. Okay.
So, s'il te plaît, j'ai une question.
Yes.
Tu montres la zone entre theta 1 et plus. Pourtant, là, c'est plutôt 0 theta 1. Quand tu montrais la zone où x1 doit être.
Ouais, c'est 0 theta 1.
Ah oui, parce que tu étais en train de montrer la zone après theta 1. Ça,
non, ça, on part de là, en fait.
Ok.
On part de là. On pourrait faire l'inverse, hein, ok. On pourrait partir de là et arriver dans cette zone-là. Mais ici, on part d'une condition initiale là-dedans.
D'accord.
Et on va arriver sur une droite comme ça. Donc, par exemple, sur le segment K2 sur gamma 2 ici, comme ça, là. Comme ça.
Ok.
Okay,
ouais.
Le plus vite possible.
D'accord.
Voilà. So, we have to do some technical hypothesis that we can find in the nice article by Jean-Luc and Maddalena, but I will mention at the end of the paper. It's all taken from this article. I didn't write the reference here, but it will be at the end.
C'est pas un problème. Ne t'en fais pas.
We have some bit weird. When it's written like that, hypothesis on the constants. So the first one is that now this one can be easily understood. Because it means that the threshold is smaller than kj over gamma j. So it means that when you look at the steady state here, the threshold is smaller than. So, okay. And the other one are conditions on the geometry of the separatrix, okay, that allow to find some suitable U min and U max that allow to make transitions between the two steady states. Thanks to the two controls taking value U min or U max. Okay, it is the assumption 2 actually, because we have a point here which is a focal point for the system, okay, and which will be very important for the control strategy. So if we choose well U-min and U-max, okay, thanks to this control strategy, which corresponds to a first phase where the control is U-min and then you go to U-max, then you do the following. Here, you leave from x0, you choose U-min, you are attracted by this point, which is phi star, the point phi star, that is chosen above the separatrix, which is plotted here. Okay, and thanks to the choice of the parameter, the assumption one on the previous slide, we can choose either this point here or on the other side. This is why it's important to satisfy the previous condition. Okay, but here we choose some U-min so that the point phi star is on this side. So when you choose U-min, okay, we do this trajectory here, and here the trajectory is attracted by this point. Okay, so we pass through the separatrix, and when we are on the other side, okay, we choose U equal to U max, and we reach the target in finite time. Okay, so on the control, the control can be seen here. Okay, we have a U-min until a switching time TS, and then you have U-max. Okay, so we see that the problem that we are considering is can be done, it's feasible.
Phi star is reached in finite time.
Phi star is not reached in finite time, but
what do you say when you are here?
When we have passed through the separatrix, actually, we can shoot whenever we want.
And you can switch whenever you
we
want.
We can switch to U max. And thank you for your remark, because actually the optimal control problem will be reduced to know when we have to do this. But what is the best switching time, actually? But in order to reduce the problem to this question, we have to apply some principle and some optimization, maximum principle. That we okay. So, but the main problem is that the system that we are considering is not smooth. First. However, in each zone, the dynamics is very simple, actually, because we have some dynamics which are affine and okay. So when we studied this problem with Agustin, the question was okay. We have a two-dimensional system, and which is linear. It should not be so difficult to find the optimal control. So, except that here we are in piecewise setting. Okay, so this is why we studied this problem, actually. We read in the literature of the hybrid Pontryagin principle, and we found a version that could be applied to our system. That is taken from this article from Dimitruk and Kaganovic. Okay. As I said, we use the fact that the dynamics is very simple, restricted to given domains. Okay. So thanks to, I'm going to detail a bit in the next slides, but the main result is the following, actually, and which it has a nice geometric interpretation. It is that for our problem, I forgot something. I forgot that Of course, in the hybrid setting, as we have different dynamics depending on the zones, actually we have to do some hypothesis about the sequence of zones, about the sequence of zones that are followed by the trajectory. And actually, what we assume in our principle will be that we follow first this zone, then this one, and in the third one is this zone. Okay.
Sorry.
But yes.
I have a question. Like the contour can take any value, or you can only take u min u max.
No, it is in the interval u min u max.
Okay. Okay. Like
it's a value. Here you can take value. And it can be a very strange curve, and if you want to...
You are a coaster of that game?
Yeah,
second one. He only did the simulation. He's my computer assistant. So.
I need this light.
Okay. And so... no, it's not true.
Of course.
By imposing this sequence of zones, this one, then this one, and this one, we obtain that the optimal control follows, can be written as a nice feedback flow as a function of the state. So, and actually, in order to answer to Frederick's question, here the optimal time optimal strategy is that. Is when the switch occurs exactly on the separatrix. We are on the limit case actually. And so if you leave from an initial condition here, what happens is that with u min you go to the separatrix corresponding to a controlled u max, then you choose u max, and you reach this point, which is very singular, which is a Filipov equilibrium point that is a. But because of Filipov property, non-smooth world, it can be reached in finite time. While, it is a kind of, for this, the initial system, it is a saddle point. So for a smooth system, you cannot reach a saddle point in finite time, sorry. Here we are in a non-smooth system, so we reach it in a finite time, okay? And then, we follow the dynamics of this zone here in order to reach the target x2f. So what is interesting is that if you take over initial condition here, for instance, you will follow exactly the same curve. Okay, so there is a kind of geometric feature of this system. So I'm going in order to for you to know a bit what. What is the principle that I applied? I'm going to detail a bit. I'm sorry for the notations, but actually, what you have to understand is that we have some different dynamics in the different zone. Okay, and what we is sufficient to do in order to tackle this problem in a with a maximum principle is that. You can lift the problem on a more higher dimensional space by considering every dynamics. Okay, so you consider the product space, and you are in a higher dimensional space, and then you can apply the maximum principle, which is smooth, the smooth maximum principle on this lift system. Okay, so what you consider here, I'm sorry for the notation, but here is that you will consider every dynamics of the zone. So you have here, as I said, you have we choose to take three zones, okay? So three dynamics. The one that is here, the other one that is in B00, and the other one in B01. So here you will have like three vector field, F1, F2, F3. Okay? And you can you consider so the free dynamics, which will be defined by xk. The trajectory will be xk, and the control in corresponding will be the corresponding control will be uk. Okay. And you can put some constraints. Okay. And the goal is to actually what is important is that the times at which you have the changes of zones are not fixed by our principle. Okay. Those times are the t0 and t nu here in the general setting. Okay. So this is the theoretical problem that we study. And actually, what you can write is the classical Hamiltonian in each zone. So you can define like adjoint vector lambda k associated with xk in each zone. You define the Hamiltonian hk. Okay? And actually, what the hybrid maximum principle state is that more or less you can maximize the optimal control strategy will maximize the Hamiltonian in every zone, okay, as in the smooth case. However, what you have is that you have some transversality and discontinuity conditions at the when the dynamics when you have the changes of dynamics. Okay, so here if you have the time t1 at which the dynamics changes, you will have stronger conditions of transfer between the two zones, okay, which are expressed here thanks to a Lagrangian function which takes into account all the constraints on the system. Okay, so it is a I'm sorry for because it's a bit technical, but
because of course you have to say that when you reach the boundary, you start from the same point.
The trajectory has to be continuous. So okay. What we impose as constraint here is that actually if here we in the first zone you have x1 and after you have x2, okay, what you have to impose is that actually x1 at t1 minus is equal to theta 1 and x2 at t1 is equal also to theta 1. Okay, you have that kind of the first dynamics is equal to the second one at the boundary, and here the value of the first component is fixed equal to theta 1. Okay, so it's not technical, and thanks to this using the fact, for instance, here we see actually we can reduce in first time actually the strategy of the proof of the main result is as very often in optimal control, we go let's say backward. So when we first by analyzing what happens, what has to be the optimal trajectory in bit 01, and actually we can prove that in bit 01 it is by a simple dynamical study. You have to, the optimal control is to take u equal to u max. So we can reduce the problem to looking for trajectories which follow the zone B10 and then B00. Okay, we can reduce to the case of two dynamics. Actually, we have a first vector field in the zone B10 and then the second one in B00. Okay, they are very simple, those vector fields. Okay, and actually, thanks to simple analysis of the condition for singular arcs, we can we can show that in the zone B00 there is no singular arcs, which are actually, if, I don't know if you are familiar with this, but the Hamiltonian can be written as H equal to H0 plus the control times certain Hamiltonian H1, okay? And the maximization condition of the maximum principle gives that U is equal to U min or U max, excepted when the term in others that has to be maximized is equal to zero, which is H1 here, okay? So this condition, and in this case, we have what we call a singular arc. And here, the singular arc can take other values and more complicated, can follow more complicated laws than the values u min and u max. So here, what we can show is that if we are studying singular arcs in the intermediate zone, B00, what we obtain is a contradiction. We obtain that gamma 1 has to be equal to gamma 2. However, it was excluded by your choice of the parameters, okay? By the assumption on the parameters that I showed at the beginning of the presentation. So, actually, so we reduce the control strategy to bang arcs, and then we can show that due to the dimension, which is very low, which is equal to 2, we can show that there is at most one switch between the two bang arcs. So we have a simple bang strategy. Okay. So, and then we optimize over all the bang strategies with two bang arcs. So, and we find that the switch has to occur on the separatrix. Okay, so we have a behavior here that, as I said before, if we start from different points on this side of the separatrix, the optimal strategy will go to the separatrix and then slide along it, and in order to reach the final the target, which is here in this point. If we leave from the other side of the separatrix, then the optimal control strategy is only to take u equal to u max, and then you reach the target. Okay. Actually, yeah, we worked on a kind of relaxed problem because the initial goal was to reach the steady state. Okay, the steady state that is phi that was phi 0 1 0, which was here, okay. And so we can wonder if we can add constraints on the optimal control problem in order to ensure that we are not too far from this steady state at the end of the optimal control strategy. Okay, so we added a constraint on x1 that was, you know, that in the initial problem we had only this constraint for x1. So we added on the last simulation, what we did is that we added a constraint that x1 as of TF has to be less than some epsilon, okay? And what we noticed, it's just a numerical result, is that the trajectory, depending on the value of the constraint epsilon, okay, is that the trajectory still follows the separatrix. So here, we added the constraint on x1 here, for instance, with the here with the red point we added a constraint epsilon equal to 0.05, okay? And we noticed that the trajectory follows the separatrix and then ends at this point here. And it is the same with other constraints on x1, okay? And they reach different points, okay? But what is interesting is that, yes, it is this geometrical characterization, okay? In the last phase,
we don't have uniqueness in the last phase.
In the last phase, we don't have uniqueness. This is why the here we have some kind of
You could go straight to the thing and then stay there.
The trajectory is the same. We have not uniqueness.
In the figure is the first thing that Bokop gives you.
We did the simulation with Bokop, and here we have many. You have many trajectories, but. The time is the same when you put u equal to u max and then u equal to 1.
Yes.
Okay.
Because what is the changing in this case? The control, is it changing in the last part?
The last part? No, actually. Yes. Here we have to reach a more restricted zone.
Yes.
Yeah? And actually, in this part, the controls, all the controls that are plotted here with Bokop are equivalent to the case where we take u first when we are here at the saddle point. We take u equal to u max and then u equal to 1.
Ah, okay.
Those strategies are just given by numerical simulation, but,
but
correspond to the same
u
time.
Max to u max?
Yeah.
To 1.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
They are equivalent to this case, okay?
But because the bottleneck there in that region is not the control. It's the dynamics that you cannot control, so you have to wait. That's why you can go up at the point and then you have to wait at some point. So every solution that gets you up that high is good. It's a good one.
Yeah, and actually this is due really to the piecewise affin setting, because because here we cannot control at all the x1. So if we take an approximation of the dynamics by Hill functions or things like that, you actually, if the slopes are too high, it will be more or less the same. But if the slopes are low, maybe you can control more easily the component x1, okay? Because in the dynamics, it would not be zero on x1.
I wonder if it wouldn't be. I mean, I'm not stronger than Bokop. Bokop knows better than maybe. I wonder if you wouldn't be better by applying umax. In the first zone, you apply umax.
You mean
on the there you apply umax.
You mean?
Wouldn't if you apply umax there? Wouldn't x1 go faster to the left, and then?
And if you apply umax here?
Yes.
You would not be able to change the zone. Because your attractive point will be in this zone or in this one.
But you can go to U11, no?
What?
You cannot do the same but the far right.
Actually, here, the dynamics is not controlled at all. Because the two step functions are equal to zero. And the two S minus are equal to zero here. This is why it was a bit hidden in my presentation. But here actually, well, if we leave from a point here, there is just the free dynamics, which is only the degradation rate. And then we arrive either in this zone, either in this one. It is the zone is not stable. Okay, so if we are here, we will study the problem that I presented with an initial condition here on the boundary, for instance, okay? And if we are here, we only take u equal to u max, and then you go here, okay? But, yes.
Yeah, okay.
And, yep.
I think I don't understand your last plot. Why you have you change the control or not? You have like the five different.
Yeah, lines. Here the trajectories are different because of numerical reasons. Mm. Because there is not the uniqueness of the
So it's the same control.
Yeah, you can put u equal to u max and then u equal to 1 and you when you have reached the target in x2 you choose u equal to 1 and then what you will do is that you will slide along this line and you will in a certain time you will satisfy the constraint in x1 and then you stop your control strategy.
What I find surprising is that in that case, what is difficult is to bring x1 to a very low value. Mm. And for the first part of your control, you act as if the difficult part was getting x2 to x2x.
Yes.
And so I would have expected that you would have needed to modify the control at the beginning in order to solve this.
We thought it would be the case, but here. Yeah,
Bokop told you.
We thought that there would be a trade off between the two mm-hmm. constraints. But actually, what is interesting is that here, we thought that when we did the simulation, that we would need to go on the other side.
But if you keep going with x min and then switch, you still have an optimal solution because of
here I don't think so. If we go closer to this point with u equal to u min, and then you put u max, I think that the trajectory will not be optimal. And it's not. But
think that too.
Yeah. But I'm smarter than Bokop.
This is the first fact that we studied numerically, and then we also studied some comparisons of the trajectories with the smooth case. So here we assume that the step function is very we have a step function for the function s minus, okay? But in some cases in biology, I think that it is also relevant to study cases where we have a more smooth case, where the step function is a rather Hill function under this form, okay? And for the simulation, actually, I want to say that we did simulation with Bokop in a smooth case, but with a coefficient k equal to 500. So it is really not smooth, almost piecewise. So, we did some simulation in the different case where the coefficient is equal to 3, is equal to 10, and is equal to 500. And what with the same, the initial problem of the x2f only the constraint on the state x2. And what is interesting is that for the smooth case, we still obtain that we have bang bang one trajectories. Okay, there is no theoretically. It's more tricky, actually. I did not manage to prove that there are no singular arcs, for instance. It is because of structure is more complex, because in our case we studied really affine dynamics, so it was easy to write all the conditions and to show that there are no singular arcs. But here, if we study non-smooth case, it is more complex. So actually, here we have plotted the different optimal trajectories depending on the coefficient k. And we see that here the blue curve, which is our piecewise curve, the curve obtained in the piecewise, is a kind of limit case when the k is large, okay? And what is interesting is that we preserve the bank strategy, and that the switching time actually for our piecewise case is a lower bound on the other switching time. Okay, it's here. And moreover, the minimal time is also the system is faster with the piecewise affine case. If we take a small k here, the system is slower. Okay. So, theoretically, it could be interesting to investigate also this case, of course. But we did only some simulations.
You could not investigate the case where you would be very close to the discontinuous case.
I don't know how to quantify this.
To quantify, you know, where you would have a curve very close of the blue curve.
Yeah, maybe there is a bound.
By a kind of a linearization or.
The system is just a fine.
I say a linearization around this this curve.
Around the. But actually, what is interesting is that, speaking of singularities, is here this point is a Filipov saddle point, which looks like here we have like
Nicolas, il faut pas que tu vises bientôt.
Okay. And here we have a field which is like that, okay, with some attractive direction and repulsive direction, okay, but it is non-smooth. If we go in the smooth case, we will have a kind of always this direction here, but here we will have curves like that, which are hyperbolic branch. Here they follow such hyperbolic. The trajectory follows doesn't follow exactly the attractive direction because it is we cannot reach the equilibrium point in finite time, but we follow an hyperbolic branch. Okay, it is really we see that there is a limit case when k is large. Okay, and so to conclude, of course, maybe it would be interesting to study the case to apply our control method, material control method, to more complex loops of higher dimension, of course, and also maybe to apply control to some loops, feedback loops, where we have oscillatory behaviors, okay, and also maybe interconnected systems. So we can have here this work is in revision for International Journal of Robust and Nonlinear Control, and has been published as a proceeding of I didn't write this, but of ADHS. I forgot to write. Okay. There's the team Biocore, if you know this team.
Okay.
Okay.
Merci. Bon, là, comme c'est un peu tard, je crois qu'il faut que...
J'ai compris. T'as compris?
Je
te dépêche.